This video is sponsored by Squarespace. Whether you need a website, a domain, or an online store, make it with Squarespace. Check the link in the description below for 10% off your first order. Hey guys, I'm Nate. Welcome back to the workshop. Not long ago, we had a video where we showed you how to make your own tornado tube using a couple of 2-liter soda bottles. My favorite part of that video was the look of when we had the swirling glow-in-the-dark water next to a black light. I thought that the glowing swirls really resembled the look of the northern lights, but in that vortex, all of it drained out and stopped working very quickly. So the purpose of today's video is to see if we can build a lamp that gives us that continuous glowing swirl that I think looks like the northern lights. Here are the supplies that we're going to be using for this build. I have a clear plastic jar with a lid that screws on watertight, a simple black light keychain, a low volume submersible water pump, some extra wire, some heat shrink, a couple of on-off switches, the top of a bendy straw, and some glow-in-the-dark paint. To help with the build, I also have soldering iron equipment, some wire strippers, and a heat gun. I've also got a glue gun for attaching some small pieces together and making sure everything is watertight. As a first step, let's drill a small hole in the bottom of the container where the cord to the pump will come out of our whole lamp. Now we need to cut off the cord so we can fit it through the hole. Now with our cord split, we need to run one end through the hole in the bottom of our container. In the video where I showed how to build a desktop vortex fountain, some people pointed out that my cord splicing technique was pretty poor. So I've tried to upgrade that and improve it so it's a little more safe. So instead of just twisting the ends of this cord together, I'm going to twist them, then solder them, then heat shrink them together. There we go, those pieces are now nicely soldered together. Slip our heat shrink over the soldered parts. Now just to keep the two wires from coming apart, I am going to wrap a little bit of electrical tape around the joint. Now some of you may be wondering why I didn't add a switch in since I already had the cord spliced. Well, I am planning to add an on-off switch, but it isn't the type of switch that requires the cord to be cut like that. So I had to cut it just to fit it through the edge of the jar, but now I need to add the switch in a little bit farther up the cord. So here's how this type of switch works with our wires. We'll take our electric cord and split it down the middle a little bit. We won't cut it across, so it will still be intact. While we're splitting our cord, we want to make sure that we don't cut into any of the wire itself, just through the plastic housing. Now let's clip in the middle, and just to make sure that it will fit and line up nicely without the wire ever touching, let's clip off just about an eighth of an inch so that we now have a gap, even if we lined it back up. One side of our wire goes around to the side, and the other side has a split in the middle at the plastic partition. Now we should be able to take the other side of our switch, fit it back on, and have those spikes stab down into our split wire. And just like that, we've installed a switch in the middle of the cord. With the cord cut, passed through the wall of the plastic container, spliced together, and with the switch added in the middle of the line, now let's attach our pump to the bottom of our plastic container permanently. We want to make sure we have our pump lined up where we know we want it. We'll gently pull it out, and then let's add some hot glue to the bottom, both on the suction cups and on the main body itself. After that's applied, we'll lower it back down into place and hold it firmly there until the glue has begun to cool. With the pump where we want it, we can pull the cord back out so it's as tight as it can get, and then seal up the hole around the cord using more hot glue. With the pump in place, let's take the cut section of our bendy straw and fit it down into the nozzle in our pump. Now I've got the straw pointed back in the same direction that the cord is going. That's because we're going to be adding a small light into the side of the container, and we want the flow of the straw to be aimed almost directly at that light. This way we can keep the light and the wires coming out of it pointed in the same direction as our power cord. Now this little black light keychain is an extremely simple mechanism. It does have a small switch you can turn, or it can be activated just by squeezing it. On the inside of this, one of the wires coming out of the light bulb is being held up at an angle so it's not making contact with the power source, which is a couple of button cell batteries. We want to remove the light bulb, but still use the casing and the power source. Because of that, we have to add in our own switch somewhere else in the line. We're going to remove the small LED light bulb, and that will end up being installed in the side of the plastic container up here. We'll then use some extra wire to connect the power source to the light bulb through the switch. And see, we've got our button cell batteries. It says 3 volts, which means that the two of them together is giving us 6 volts to power our LED. Let's take a length of 4 or 5 inches from our red and black wire and cut that off. Separate the wire. Let's use our wire strippers and take off just a small bit at the end of our wire, less than 1/2 inch, about 1 centimeter. Now we want to fit this wire back into the casing, one on top of the batteries and one on the bottom of the batteries. There we go, I think we've got the wires in contact with the battery. So now let's put the screws back in place. We also aren't going to need these key ring pieces, so let's get rid of those. Actually split this wire all the way down so we've got 2 separate wires coming out of our battery pack. Let's pull off the ends of these wires and see if touching the ends of our LED will get it to light up. Bingo! We have light. It's just what we want to see. Now before we start permanently attaching wires together, we need to get some good measurements. So let's drill a hole in the side of our container where we can attach our LED light bulb. There we go. Now let's use a drill bit the same size as the body of our LED and drill a small hole into the side of our plastic container. Our LED now fits very smoothly into the side of our plastic container, which is just what we want. So now we can have one wire go straight from our battery pack up to the bulb, and the other wire will take a small detour through our switch before it goes to the bulb as well. Those solders and heat shrink should do a pretty good job of making sure that our bulb is well attached to the wires and that it's not in any danger of shorting from any wires touching each other. However, just to be sure, because this is going to be near liquid, let's use a little bit of hot glue and make sure that the leads on the back of the LED are completely covered. There we have it. I think every bit of exposed metal is now covered with our hot glue. At this point, we just need to connect the other end of the on-off switch to the other end of the battery pack, and we should have a complete circuit. Before I solder these together, just holding them together, as soon as I turn the switch, perfect! That's exactly what we want to see. On, off. There we go, at this point we have our complete circuit, our switch is working, our light bulb is working, everything is working perfectly, just what we want to see. Now our light bulb will go right here, battery pack will go right here, and our wires will all run together like this. So I just want to tape these all together so we have one consistent cord. One more step to make this nice and permanently attached is to use some hot glue to go all the way around this light bulb so no water or liquid can leak out of that gap. At this point, I think we've got all of the electronics hooked up, so it's time to make our glow-in-the-dark fluid and fill our lamp. We don't want to necessarily mix up our glow-in-the-dark fluid inside the lamp container itself. I'll show you why in a minute. So we're going to be using a separate, larger container to mix it up in, and then we'll transfer it once we're ready. To make sure we have the right amount, but not too much, let's fill our container all the way up, pour it into this container, and then add a little bit more to the pitcher. This is also going to work as a test to see how well our 2 holes filled with hot glue are doing. So far, perfect. Goes all the way to the very, very top. Now let's pour that into our pitcher. And now let's add maybe another cup or so. It's not very important. We want to make sure we have enough, but not so much that we're gonna end up with a ton of extra liquid in the pitcher. Now we want to take our bottle of glow-in-the-dark acrylic paint and pour about half of it into this water. Now let's stir that up until it's all dissolved into the water. At this point, if we use our black light and hold it up against the water turned on, we should be able to see it picking up the glow from the paint. There you go, it's pretty faint right there, but I'm in a well-lit studio, so it's not gonna show up too well, but you can still see it swirling away. To increase the contrast between the glowing portion of our liquid and the non-glowing portion, let's also add several drops of blue food coloring. This will darken the liquid overall, but it will still shine brightly when it's glowing. We're not trying to make squid ink here, we're just going for a little bit darker of a shade. There we go, we have our glow-in-the-dark liquid and we now want to transfer it back into the smaller container. But we are going to go back to the sink to do that because we're going to fill it so much that it's on the brink of overflowing. Now let's start adding the liquid, and as I said, we're going to fill it up to the very, very top. It'll be so full that when we put the lid on the jar, that should actually cause more of the liquid to spill out over the container. Here goes. Combination of the glow-in-the-dark paint and the blue food coloring, you can't even really see any of the internal components. The pump is now invisible. Fill and let it overflow even a little bit to try and get rid of some of those bubbles. There we go. Now as I'm filling, it's just running down the sides of the container, which means it is very full, which is just how we want it. So now, while it's still overflowing like that, let's carefully put our lid on and screw it down tight. And as you can see, as I'm screwing it on, it's actually squishing some extra liquid out. It's perfect. There we go. Nice and tight. And by doing that, we minimize the amount of bubbles that show up. There are still a couple of them, but for the most part, they'll just be hidden up inside the cap and we'll never see any of the bubbling. We have our glow-in-the-dark liquid, our pump, and our black light in the jar. So at this point, we should be able to plug it in, turn on both switches, and have a swirling, glowing liquid. All right. Light on, pump on. I think we're getting a good effect. Now, we're still in a very well-lit studio, so you can't see almost anything of this, but let's turn out the lights and see how this is looking. So while we were trying to get some shots of this Aurora Borealis lamp, we're having a hard time picking up some of the contrast that we can see with the naked eye. It looked best on camera right where the pump was pointing all of the glow-in-the-dark liquid right at the LED light bulb, but the LED light itself gave off so much light that it was pretty distracting. So to add to the decor effect, what I did was take some opaque black tape and cut it in the profile of a mountain range. So now it looks like we're kind of seeing a moon rising behind a mountain with some northern lights flowing around the sky as well. I'm actually really happy with the look. So there you have it. I think we have fairly successfully built a Northern Lights lamp. It looks pretty cool. There's a lot of good swirling motion going along, and that's what I really wanted. I really wish that our camera could capture how it shows up to the naked eye, because the contrast between where the LED is and the green swirling lights is not quite so exaggerated. So it really looks like this slight blue glow behind a mountain, and then the swirling green of the Aurora Borealis behind it. Once again, thank you to Squarespace for sponsoring this video. Squarespace provides a wide variety of designer templates, so your website will reflect your vision. They've got award-winning 24/7 customer service to help you build the site that you need, and it's easy to set up or transfer an existing domain over to Squarespace. Head to squarespace.com for a free trial, and when you're ready to launch, go to squarespace.com/kingofrandom for 10% off of your first purchase of a website or domain. Thanks for joining us for this project today, and remember to come grab your hats, shirts, and other cool merch at thekingofrandom.com. See you there. That's right.
Hey guys, thanks so much for caring about our content and our channel so much. It really is amazing to have great people like you jumping in to watch every new video that gets uploaded and watching it to the end. You really are amazing, and we appreciate you for that.